Good evening and welcome to Ask the Mayor. This is our first program for 2017. I'm Curt Morris, the mayor of San Dimas. To my right is Blaine Michaelis, the city manager. As always, the primary purpose of this program is to let you give us a call and ask questions, make comments. But we also have some things prepared that we're going to talk to you about. But please feel free to interrupt us. And I would like to just tell you that we have back with us the originator of this program. Actually, Ken Pucci was, when he was at Time Warner, when we first started many years ago, was the guy who said, well, you ought to give that a try. And we did. He was amazed when he came in, and we're still doing it.
Maybe we should have him as a guest sometime.
We will. We'll have him as a guest. So, Blaine, how are things?
Things are good. We're a little wet out there, but I think we're okay.
The rain hasn't done us any serious damage?
San Dimas drains really well. Now, I appreciate this because we pay attention to this kind of thing, but San Dimas has had some good engineering through the years, and it helps that we're on a slope anyway, but we had a little bit of flooding today on one of the intersections, which we've taken care of, but that's really about it, even though we've had well over an inch and a half of rain today, so we're okay.
Well, what do you have to offer for our viewers tonight?
I always like to reward those who take a moment and send us an email or a call ahead of time and give us a question. And so may I share
Absolutely.
The communication that came from one of our viewers that was interested in the street maintenance plan for Cienega and also Valley Center. As the person who contacted us pointed out, not all of Valley Center is under the control of San Dimas. In fact, in most cases, only the east curb of that street is really in our city limits. But the pavement from that curb all the way to the west is either the county of Los Angeles or the city of Glendora. And so the question was, when are those streets going to be repaired? And if anyone's driven those streets, they'll have the same question. You know, when is it going to be repaired? And knowing that Glendora has the primary responsibility, well, if it's Glendora, is there any way you can do to encourage Glendora to be able to step up the maintenance on that street? So, well, we're happy to make those suggestions to a neighboring city, but it would be subject to their plans for street maintenance. On the other hand, the question was on Cienega. This is from Lone Hill to Arrow Highway. That project and repair is scheduled for May of 2017, this year. And so I think in the past we've kind of reviewed how the city goes about making its maintenance decisions. We have an engineering evaluation of all the asphalt quality of all the streets and their condition in the city. And they're rated, you know, those by a formula and a category. And that rating helps us to concentrate on those areas of greatest need or helps us schedule and anticipate when a street is ready for either just an overlay or a chip seal or a slurry or a complete rebuild. We use the engineering assessments of those streets to help us plan ahead because there's a lot of difference in expense from a slurry and a complete rebuild. So in the case of Cienega, it will require rebuild in most cases along that street. And so when we're able to, so we design it 1 year in a fiscal year, and then that helps, that's our task for that year is to get all of our engineering design work done. And we prepare specifications, you know, what kind of a street maintenance program are we going to do on that particular street for the next year. So we do the engineering design 1 year and then prepare them to go out to bid in future years, usually the next year. The other thing that our public works staff does that I think it's very helpful and interesting to know is we try and combine several street maintenance projects together. If you're going to bid for street maintenance and the project is $700,000 in of work versus if you're going out to bid for a $1.8 million project, you attract a different contractor and you're able to achieve an economy of scale, especially if you're doing the same kind of work. They only have to bring their equipment into town once. They can, you know, they use their staging area only once to do two jobs or three jobs instead of having to replicate those costs by doing them one at a time. And so in the case of Cienega, it's being combined with another major street project, which is the rebuild of San Dimas Avenue from Via Verde going north to Puddingstone. That's another street that folks know has need. In fact, our frustration is the ground moves underneath that street. We did a kind of a semi repair 5 years ago to take out a hump, and 3 years later the hump came back. It's so under the ground moves on us, and we have to deal with it. So we're combining those two projects together, the San Dimas Avenue one and Cienega, into a more of a major project, and we'll be out to bid on that so that we're scheduled to start in May of 2017. The caller was also, or the contact was also interested, couldn't we publish, you know, when we're going to do street maintenance or which streets we're going to do, so that people could look online and find out, you know, the schedule. Probably 80% of our street repair we can, and I think in some cases we do post that information, especially if it's a residential slurry seal. Those are things we do schedule on. We used to do a 7-year cycle, now we're able to extend that a little bit longer. So we could publish those, and I think that's a good idea the caller had suggested. So those that we know that we'll be doing as part of a fiscal year or scheduled to do next year, we could post those so that people could anticipate and plan. When it gets to the bigger projects, they're subject to the bidding process. And when we get to the bigger numbers, we hope we set aside enough money, but if the cost of oil or a slurry mix, or if the contractors are very busy, sometimes the prices are a little higher than what we had anticipated, and we may need to regroup or take funds from our reserves to get those projects done.
Just before we go too far, you mentioned that we're doing our slurry seal program now. It's about 7 years, but we're extending it. I think it's worth explaining. We once did it on a 10-year interval. And we did it, we reduced that interval and for good reasons, because it's better for maintenance and all that for 7 years. Our reason for increasing is actually because the technology and the materials are better. Isn't that correct?
That's right.
I mean, we're actually not, it's not that we're doing it for financial reasons or other things. It's that we don't need, because of the availability of the so-called chip seal or whatever that's called, we're able to put a better slurry seal on it. So that's based, we're moving that out based on technology.
Right, there's different formulas and new mixes. Like a slurry, if folks remember, it's a mixture of emulsion of oil and some sand, and they can add some fibrous material now, which is this extra ingredient. And anything that you can do in that mixture so that it wears longer, or it seals the moisture in the street so it doesn't crack as much, or it holds its binding, you know, those oils. And that's what the products that we're finding, as we put those into the slurry mix, they're, after 7 years, they're doing just fine. So we don't want to spend money we don't need to. And so there are sometimes that mix may allow us to come back on a 10-year basis, because the quality of that mix is going to last a little longer. And our public works staff has been using chip seal, which is where we will put an oil emulsion down and then put either small pieces of gravel that are a certain size, and then they'll open it up to street traffic, and that kneads in those rocks, which is even better than sand, to get a longer term. And so those could be 15 years. So, but you can't do those on residential streets or some streets. It's only on some collector. So every street needs are different, and its solution is going to be different. But
do we still use an outside company to give us opinions on the quality of our streets?
Right. This rating system I talked about, there are engineering firms that specialize in that. And we use them to not only prepare it, but update it. You know, it's not a matter of just, you do it once and you've got all the roads all assessed. I think Krishna has them on schedule every 3 years. They'll come and do a refresher. And also they update it too. Like when we do a street maintenance project, they incorporate that into our maintenance program so that they can say, well, this street was done this time. And so we're always able to remember when we did what we did and when was that time, and know what the rating is to plan our next several series. And Krishna goes out 3 to 5 years in his thinking, as far as how, Krishna, by the way, is our public works director. So he thinks ahead and anticipates, because We do have money we set aside for future years so that we know we're ready to do those projects when time comes.
You know, I think the idea of putting onto our website and publicizing that it's there, some sort of schedule of when projects are going to be done, might be interesting to a lot of people, not only the projects like streets, but maybe other projects as well, like the parks.
Yep, can do. So, but thank you, our listener that sent an email. We appreciate that, and the email address is on the screen, and that is a helpful thing to us, because then we can come prepared to answer the question maybe in a little bit more detail, and we know we're giving you something you're interested in. So
good.
But outside of that, it's the new year, and that's the only email we got. So
well, I think we talked about maybe at the last time we sort of did a little bit of a review of the year, but we didn't finish of all the things that were done last year. Are there any things that you would like to sort of pick up on before we start talking about the things we're doing the coming year?
Probably the one that folks are most interested in is the downtown project, and let me just give a quick update. The concrete and the large portions of the work are in essence completed. There's a small section toward the west, heading toward Cataract, that still has yet to be poured as concrete. But all the sidewalks in the downtown and the off streets have been completed. There's a little bit of work to do in the alley next to Feed and Grain. And so when we're back and the sun's dried things out a bit, then they'll finish up that section. But the next thing to go in is primarily the rest of the street furniture, and they've done most of it now, but the rest of the mailboxes, the benches, the trash cans, and all of those will be finished. We've made decisions on signage for the downtown, and so those signs are being fabricated probably in the next 3 to 4 weeks after we get all the information from the downtown businesses. And then there are 5 signs downtown, so they're placed so that you can see ahead of the block, you know, what those businesses are, and so that those signs will probably be going up maybe the middle of February after they're fabricated and all set. And so, but the pots are the next thing. No pots have been installed yet. There's a pot that goes on either side of the trees along Bonita. And so they're large pots. They're almost 38 inches tall, and so they're heavy. They have to be installed by a forklift. And so, but once they're ready to go, they're completely plumbed with the irrigation water available and the drainage in the pot itself. So no waste of water and a very efficient watering system. And so then those plants are, of course, pots are filled with plants. And then there's a little bit more of the electrical things to do. Folks may notice that the lights in the grates are, most of them are on. And so there's some other electric things we'll be doing as well. And then the finishing touches on the public Wi-Fi system. So all of that is anticipated to be finished about the middle of February, pending the rain. And then we are going to rebuild that section of Bonita Avenue. And so we're out to bid on that project now. And so the goal would be to get all of these things done by late February, because on March 15th, we want to have a dedication ceremony on that Saturday to have people come and...
It'll probably still be raining.
It may be. It may be.
And that's okay, too.
Yes.
Well, okay, then, that continuing project is a continuing big project for the year. What do you envision kind of next year is to, we have repeated here or told people about kind of the way we come up with how much money we have to spend for capital improvements. And so we've made a determination of what we had available to spend in October, I believe. Mm-hmm. So you've allocated the money to the things you're going to use it for. And what kind of things can we look for in the coming year?
We just let the bid to do a complete reconstruction and replacement of all the playground equipment at Villa Verde Park. As folks know now, it's kind of located in different levels of the park. It'll all now be on one level so that it's easily accessible. And so that project is scheduled to begin on the 23rd of January. Now, the contractor may not be out there with his equipment, but he's will turn the project over to him that day. It will be under construction probably until even May. So there are a couple of events in Villa Verde Park that will be affected by that. We usually have a spring Easter egg hunt. And so we're encouraging that maybe we wouldn't hold it at that time, that we would only do the Easter egg hunt downtown. But we would instead hold a grand opening event to replace that event at Villa Verde Park once it's finished in May, probably by the middle of May. But it'll be a terrific project. All the rest of the park will be open, the walking path will be open and so forth, but there will need to be a construction fence and work because the playground equipment is being located right near the restrooms. They're at Villa Verde Park now, and so, but there'll be some construction going on for some time, but we promise that we'll come back with some really terrific playground equipment. The new stuff is pretty exciting, but updating it and making it accessible is a good thing.
You know, it's very interesting when you have the concept of the playground equipment has to be accessible, so therefore you can't have it where climbing a hill, which used to be considered pretty good exercise.
Sure.
You have to climb a hill between the sections of the playground equipment. But to make it accessible to all, that's the reason for the actual change of location.
And to give folks an understanding of how we work our budget system, we had set aside $400,000 for that project and then went through the design engineering to get it all done. By the time the bids came in, it was over $500,000 project. And so this past October, when we identified funds that were available from the previous fiscal year, it allowed us to be able to use some of those funds to simply go ahead with the project, to make up that difference and get it done, rather than have to say, well, gee, now we have to redesign or we have to delay this. It was a way for us to create a system so that when we move forward with these projects, we can get them done.
We're on the other end of an economic cycle because for several years ago, we would have our so-called engineer's estimate for a job that was going out to bid, and the bids would come in lower than that amount, sometimes substantially lower. Now it's the other way around, and the methodology for estimating is the same, but the contractors, the economy is much better for them now than it was then, and so they're bidding higher prices. Which is just the part of the, this is not something where you can go and look on the menu and say, I'll take that, that, and that,
yeah.
And they can run it through an adding machine. This is a matter that contractors will all decide how much money can we make on this.
And that's how the world turns, and we accept that because they'll come and build things that we want in our town. But it's just being able to anticipate those issues so that we can move forward and have the resources all lined up.
And it's a good place to use that to have money in our, every year we know how much we're going to have available when the year ends and we can spend that money. We're not relying on an estimate of what the income of the revenue might be. So it's worked well for us for a number of years.
And in fact, a project we're working on for 2017 the Marchand Park renovation project, which involves expanding and rebuilding practically the recreation building that's there, replacing the restroom completely, new playground equipment and other amenities to update the park. What we do is we get funds from different sources. Sometimes we'll get money paid from new development for parks and parks recreation expansion projects. And other times we can apply for a grant, you know, that's related to a certain kind of housing opportunity, so long as it goes toward recreation programs. And so when we start to identify these funds and accumulate them, it allows us to start with enough money to design a project. But as we go through that process of doing the project the way it really needs to be done, in other words, it's hard to do major projects every other year, so when you do it, you want these buildings to be functional for a long time, so you want to build it as big as it needs to be or to do all the improvements that would be necessary for the services and the program. So it's possible when you do that type of design that the money you have available may not be enough. And so right now that project is nearing, the architect is nearly finished with the construction drawings for the project, which then we'll have the city review and approve, and then they'll be ready to go to bid. So we've set aside $1.3 million of these funds we've accumulated and set aside. But if the project comes in at 1.5, again, we've set aside monies from October to be able to just simply say, okay, that's the price. We're ready to allocate those funds and move it forward.
When we talk about the rebuild of a street, for example, Bonita Avenue downtown, is that a complete rebuild going down to dirt?
This is another good example of technology. It used to be that you would kind of cut off the top 2 or 4 inches of a street and then overlay it, that would be your way of extending the street. But there are times when the underlying foundation of the street either was inconsistent, or there was water here or there, there was earth movement underneath. So the technology now is to go down deeper and go down even 8 to 10 inches and dig up all of that material. And there's base rock and then asphalt and so forth. And then to take that material and grind it up too, and then set it off to one side and let it dry out. And so that means that you need to have the space to do that in the project. But the technology this time is to take that same material and inject cement into it and mix it in as part of the mix of rocks and base and asphalt, and then recompact it and put it back into the street bed so that you, in essence, have rebuilt the entire base and bed of the street. And I mean, now we're talking about a street that'll be good for 40 or maybe 50 years. And then you can just slurry it for a while, and you may need to put a cap on it, you know, maybe every 10 or 15 or 20 years. But you have rebuilt the street from the material itself, and the cement really adds the stability so that it gives it the strength, you know, for its future. And so that's what we'll be doing. Christian's been using this for about 2 or 3 years now. Fifth Street was a street that was rebuilt, you know, using this method. That was our first experience with it. But in this case, we'll be doing that downtown.
Very good. So we're really talking about now 50-year streets.
Yes.
With appropriate maintenance over that time.
And all of these things to just spend the money wisely so that in hopes of the materials will be a friend to you through the years and give you the strength to that street you need.
You know, I can remember when I was a boy watching them build streets in San Dimas, and kind of in the western part of the old town. There was a track built there a long, long time ago. And the way they built the streets then were, they were truly oil and gravel. They may have put a little bit of oil down first, but mostly they put a lot of gravel, and then they went over with rollers and compacted everything. Then they oiled it. And they kept building it up that way, and they would build it kind of in layers, and it was an incredibly smooth street.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how long it lasted, but I guess that was basically the base of the so-called McAdam Road. It's not really the surface; it's the base that makes it the McAdam Road. So, and they 4th Street, 3rd Street were both. Built that way west of Eucla. So it was and I remember riding a bicycle on them when they were brand new. Man, it was smooth.
Yeah.
And there were no houses around, no cars. It was fun. But do we have other street projects? You've already mentioned we're going to do that San Dimas Avenue. That's going to be a major job.
It will be. And so that in that sense, just so that folks know, this is that we'll have to close one lane. Well, in the case of San Dimas Avenue, and we might as well say it, the plan is we can get the project done quicker if we can even shut down the street. In other words, we can get done in 3 to 4 weeks, you know, to be able to really get in and work the street, which would otherwise take 3 months if we had to run detour, keep traffic going on that street. because then you have to work around it all the time. So, and also you pay another $100,000 in costs for that contractor because he's going to be longer on the job. So the San Dimas project, the proposal, and we'll meet with the residents. We'll contact them. We'll meet with the homeowners association to explain, you know, the project and what it will be. But we can get it done quicker and cheaper and have this.
Also, I would think substantially safer.
Yes.
Since you don't have cars going right by where people are working.
Yeah.
And since the right-of-way is fairly narrow.
And in this case, there's a pretty good detour alternative that runs parallel to San Dimas Avenue, that being the freeway. So that is the plan, but before we do that, we'll come and talk to people about it and let them know. But in the sense of downtown, when we do this resurfacing or the reconstruction in March, we are going to close and have one-way traffic in the downtown area for 1 week one way and 1 week the other. So there will be a detour if you want to go the opposite direction. But on the other end, that helps us get the street done in 2 weeks. You know, a complete rebuild in 2 weeks is a pretty quick time frame.
Phenomenal, actually.
But so we have Cienega as a project. We have San Dimas Avenue. And also we hope to realign and rebuild Golden Hills Road, which is the connection point from San Dimas Canyon Road to, we would bypass the old route and build a new street that would connect to Golden Hills Road in Laverne. And that is also a project that's scheduled for 2017. Here's a good example. We'd like to do it, but it requires the consent and agreement of the county, not just the County of Los Angeles, but the sanitation, flood control district, which in a technical way is a different animal than the county itself, Public Works. So it does take some time to have them provide the easements and the dedication and the review of the plans. So we're hoping to get that done this summer, but it's taken this long just because of those
approvals. Multi-agency projects are just more complicated.
They are.
And you have to recognize they're going to take more time.
Right. But those are our major projects. We'll still do all of our regular street maintenance, all the residential slurry seal. I don't recall which zone we're doing this year, but there'll be another regular routine of doing our street maintenance on residential streets.
Okay, very good. Well, if anybody would like to ask anything specific about where we're doing what work, just let us know. We'd be very happy to hear from you. You can send us an email. I don't think you're equipped to receive emails right now. We're well equipped here.
So if you emailed, I'll hear from you in just a minute. But here at City Hall, it just as a side note, we switched to Microsoft Word 365, and so we're adjusting to that. But
yes,
but we still can receive emails though. So
well, or you can call us. The number is on the screen. We'd be happy to hear from you anytime during this the hour that we have. What else would you have you been working on? Okay. Hello, you're on the air. Thank you very much for calling.
Hi, Mayor and Blaine. This is Pam Stevens calling your Ask the Mayor question asker. I had a question about the San Dimas Wash. Where does that water come from, and where does it go? That's my question for the evening.
Okay.
Thank you.
It comes from San Dimas Canyon. That's the main drainage for the San Dimas Canyon. And as it comes out of the canyon, it is divided by the Pudding Stone Diversion Dam, which diverts a part of the water down a flood control channel and takes it down to Pudding Stone Dam, behind Pudding Stone to that lake. The other one is, the answer to that is it continues to go down, and it goes down, and I don't know at the west end if I know exactly where it goes. It goes by, it's in a channel as it goes by Amelia and Baseline. I know that. But beyond Amelia, I, I don't know where San Dimas Wash goes.
It's funny, you're so much tied into San Dimas. I'm where you are, Mayor. I can trace it all the way to Amelia, and then because of that, the other side of is Glendora. But I'm sure it continues in that same concrete channel. I just don't, maybe it goes to Santa Fe Dam eventually?
I do not know. I'm sorry, you have stumped us. We're going to have to do some research.
Okay, well, I'm not sure you understood my question. It starts up in Horse Thief Canyon, and it looks like the wash is filled by this large tube. You know, I don't know what they call it, but anyway, it looks like that's how the wash is filled up, it coming from up that way.
Well, actually, there are two different facilities up there, and I have to remember to look at the right camera. There are two different facilities up there. One is the water that comes, at least a part of the water that comes from the California Aqueduct System, goes to Cal State Lake. Then it comes down in a pipe, and it comes down through the foothills, and it comes actually to that corner there where you go into the Horse Thief Canyon Park, and there's a facility there that is actually a generating facility, surprisingly enough, because the water flowing down in that pipe goes, there's enough drop from up in the ridge route where it comes from to create electricity. So they generate electricity there. And it goes, and so that, but that continues, that big pipe you see, that continues and does not go into the wash. I believe it goes under the wash. The wash itself, it is true that Horse Thief Canyon is a contributory to it, but it starts farther east in San Dimas Canyon and comes down and then picks up the comes across by the park, south of the park, and there are a lot of spreading basins there. A lot of the water actually is put into the ground in the spreading basins from beyond the Puddingstone Diversion Dam. Along there, it's wide and there are little sort of dams. And then it goes down and then before it gets into the concrete channel there, and it gets into the concrete channel, I think just west.
Just before Foothill. You know, we widened the foothill, the crossing, that channel.
That channel is that's the channel, and it's upstream from there. Between there and San Dimas Canyon Road, it gets into the channel. But beyond Amelia, it used to, when it was just a natural wash, that there was just a big wide wash through sort of like where Baseline ended at Amelia, there was just a big wash and then the water sort of went out. It was a big area, and it was pretty much ended up being a spreading basin there.
You know, Pam, you mentioned something that it looks like the water starts there. Every now and then at the facility Curt described, there is a pressure release of water, and it's pretty magnificent when it happens. And especially during the drought, when they have to release that pressure, you think, my goodness, where's that water coming from? But that may give you the impression that that's feeding the water in. And every now and then when they exercise that pressure release valve, it looks like it's filling the wash too. And that does contribute to further up San Dimas Dam and San Dimas Canyon contributes most of the water.
That's exactly what precipitated this question was during the warmer weather, we would go by there and the water would be just gushing down that channel.
Yeah, I think they do, but that is primarily, surprisingly enough, and I don't remember how much electricity is generated by that facility, but it's a fair amount.
Yeah.
Because they're using the advantage of the kinetic energy of the drop from the ridge route down to San Dimas, and then it goes on further, and I think that water goes, I believe it goes over to Riverside. There's a channel down there somewhere.
What the flood control has tried to do is put a lot more spreading basins so that it doesn't just sit in a concrete channel. So when that water eventually gets into the groundwater downstream, It certainly is that way upstream too. At the diversion before it gets to putting stone, is the intent is to give the water a chance to get into the ground there too.
Yeah.
So.
But
okay, well, thank you.
Well, thank you. I'm sorry you stumped us, but you did.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks
Bye-bye.
For calling. Bye. I suspect there's some water flowing there now.
Yes, yeah, yep. I know what Pam was talking about because I've had that same question and people have called City Hall and said, we're in a drought, what's going on?
Yeah,
up there?
Why is that?
Can someone plug that
in? I know there used to be a lot of complaints when, before the improvements were made in the equestrian center, but while it was owned by the city and sort of more or less operated by us in one way or another, the water used to come down the stream, the horse, and people would complain because the horses were actually in water knee deep because the corrals were kind of down in the channel. It was not a real good facility at the time.
Yeah, but that's...
if anybody else would like to call us, you can see we're pretty easy to stump. I guess we don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know as much as we should, Blaine. Now, if you want to know where Cinnamon Creek goes and where it goes into Walnut Creek and all of that, we'd be right up there.
Yep.
So what else do you,
let's see,
can you think of?
I'm trying to think if there's something that, you know, we did prepare, what we'd like to do every now and then is prepare a summary of things as far as what, you know, what, not only what we've accomplished, but just how well are we doing in kind of a comparison way. And so we try and do that on a two-year cycle, and we've recently completed some of that stuff.
I looked at that, and I think it's actually, I think the information that's in that summary is, as it always is very interesting, and it's sometimes you're surprised by it. So do you want to talk about that a little bit?
I'd like to, and if there's any questions,
good,
folks can call in.
Good.
One of the things we kind of look at is, what's the business climate like? You know, how do businesses feel about San Dimas? If we took a look at some of our statistics, what would they tell us? And so we look at new business licenses. These aren't renewals of businesses that are here, but which licenses during the year are new? And so we total those up, and then we say, well, what kind of business licenses were they for? You know, what's the variety of the new businesses that are coming? And so the number is, it's about 186 per year, but we kind of broke it down and said it's basically 3 to 4 new businesses each week, maybe even like one a day. And so that's been happening every week, 3 to 4 per week, every week for the last 3.5 to 4.5 years. But the last 2 years has maintained that kind of growth. I think generally the economy is reflecting that. There are more people opening businesses or starting businesses, but I think it's also a point to make that they're doing the opening of their businesses in San Dimas. And it's all kinds. There's professionals of doctors and dentists and psychiatrists and professional people, all kinds of contractors, whether electrical, plumbing, or so forth. And so it's a really nice mix. And also into that, there's new stores, retail stores, 12 restaurants, 12 new business licensed restaurants opened in San Dimas just this past year. So it's helpful to look at and say, well, because if it was flat or if it wasn't increasing, that would tell us something. But and nor are we resting on our laurels on this, but when you can think that 3 to 4 new businesses are opening in San Dimas every week for the last 3.5 to 4 years, you know, those, we're heading in the better direction for that. And so we say, okay, well, how do we stack up with the number of businesses? I mean, are we maintaining them, or are they increasing overall, especially retail or stores? Because not everybody who gets a business license is a retail business. And so we look at retail businesses, and San Dimas has 1,290 retail businesses.
Really?
And so by comparison, probably Laverne and Claremont are similar in size and makeup. And so that's about 140 more than Claremont. It's 400 more than Laverne. That may surprise people. I know I don't share those because we're in competition, but just kind of for perspective. And so that's the number of businesses, and compared to it, it's more per capita than maybe what others are around us. And so then we take a look at, well, what's the strength of those businesses? How much sales are they generating? And we would use the sales tax information to help us make that kind of a decision. So under those conditions, San Dimas produces more retail sales per capita than our neighboring cities. We're at about, if I remember right, 135 sales tax dollars per person. Some of the adjacent cities, and I won't name them, are less than that. All of them are less than that, but they may be like 119 or 60 is another, $60 per capita. So new businesses are coming, retail businesses are increasing, and the strength of our retail market is the strongest in our immediate area. Gives us a feel that we're hanging in there okay. The other thing that we can look at is, what's the level of investment? Are people building things, or what's the value of the things that are built in San Dimas as compared to the other cities? And we can use the assessed valuation, the taxable assessed valuation numbers, to figure that out. And then to make it so that we can compare with other cities, we convert that to a per capita. So per capita, this was a banner year for us. We used to always be like $4 billion of tax of assessed valuation, property value in San Dimas. This year we pushed over $5 billion. So technically it's $5.02 billion. So what that means is all of the commercial, residential, industrial, all of the buildings that have any kind of assessed valuation, you add all those together, in San Dimas, it's over $5 billion.
So, and that means the market value is substantially greater than that.
Yes.
Because of the way the right. assessment works.
Right. So housing is, you know, your own personal home in San Dimas is probably assessed at less than its market value unless you recently bought it. And so, but we take a look at and compare that on a per capita basis. Per capita, San Dimas has $147,000 of value per capita, per person. Our adjacent cities are less than that, 110, 112, maybe 120 compared to 147. So the value of the real estate in San Dimas is strong. The other thing that we look at is of course, housing prices. And this is a good news, bad news story. Housing prices, the average sale of a house in San Dimas increased 11% from last year to the year before to last year. And the average sale price was $532,000 for a home in San Dimas. That's the good news and bad news is, the good news is the real estate market is very strong. And this is where we compare about equally with the other cities that are around us. The whole area has had an increase in property values and sale prices are very strong. So it's good if you're looking to sell, it's tough if you're looking to buy. But one thing it does though, it allows, if someone wants to buy a home in San Dimas, say it's below the market in its price, they know that they can fix it up and not lose in their efforts to improve that home. I know someone was saying yesterday that a home in downtown San Dimas was renovated and sold for just under, well, around $500,000. And what it does, it allows that people to come in and make those kind of investments.
And these, in many cases, are houses that are close to 100 years old.
Yeah.
They're probably, the downtown core, probably the majority of that was built before the 1920s, or in the 1920s or earlier, because I think throughout the United States, I studied American history when I was a college student, and one of the great things is people, the understanding of the Great Depression and how it was compared to the Great Recession, is that during the years of the Great Depression, there were actually, at the end, there were fewer dwelling units in the United States than there were at the beginning.
Wow.
So there is no, in fact, the decrease was a pretty good sized number. Houses fell down, whatever, but almost no houses were built during the, and you can imagine what, that's one of the reasons that the economy was so collapsed, nothing was happening. If there's no construction, that's the money is not going anywhere. So it was really pretty telling. And now it is. And one of the difficulties, as we know from looking at things that, and what we follow all the time, is that housing prices are based on the market, not on what it costs to build it.
Right.
So even if a developer comes in and says, well, let me build on half the size of the lot, so I can build twice as many, and it would be logical that land values being what land values are, that the houses would be cheaper. The houses are not cheaper. I know that when we were looking at the small lot subdivisions, people were talking about starting prices at $499. You're not saving a lot there. So affordable housing is a difficult challenge. And we don't want to beat a dead horse, but one of the mechanisms that we were cities primarily were able to help provide for, at least not low and ultra low income, but low to moderate income housing, was through the redevelopment process. A part of the money had to be used for that. There is nothing like that now. So there's not much of that kind of housing being built. In fact, I saw two things about Los Angeles and in our area in general, but this was for downtown Los Angeles. Two different studies. One was that the jobs that are being generated, almost all of them are going to be low paying jobs. Something like 75%. Many of them will be very low paying. In fact, they'll be, because the minimum wage is going up, there'll be an awful lot of that will be the job level. Some of those jobs are not happening because they can get it done cheaper other places. But LA is going through a huge housing boom downtown, building huge high rises, things. None of those are affordable by people making the wages of the jobs that are going to be generated in the next 15 to 20 years will not be able to afford any of the houses being, or the housing being built now. So it's a huge problem.
Yeah.
Not just in San Dimas, where we still do have some housing stock that's under $500,000.
Yeah.
Not much maybe, but
yeah.
But it's pretty interesting. What about in our one of our areas of that we were able to do with redevelopment is the area at Costco. Is that now fully, are all the pads?
Yes.
Occupied?
In fact, I was there on the weekend, and I think not only are they occupied, but they're open for business.
They're all open for business.
Even the eyebrow threading company. An embarrassing moment, I was going to meet Nectar Juice on Saturday, and there was someone at the door passing things out, and so I'll take one. And she looked at me, again, and then I looked at the card, and it was, do you have your eyebrows done? And so I said, I'm sorry, that's okay, you can give this to someone who could benefit from it. And so so that's why I know all the businesses are open. And so we had lunch at Waba Grill on the end and had a nice smoothie at Nectar. But that constitutes our, so Jimmy
what
John's.
What kind of food is Waba Grill?
Waba Grill is kind of everyone's with fresh nowadays, of course.
Yeah.
But it's rice, steak, salmon, chicken, vegetables, and prepared fresh, and with their special Waba sauce on it. And so it's a favorite of, it's one of those that's just coming on its own. And so, but it's primarily that kind of food, very fresh and tasty. And
you know, I think one of the things that is interesting, to me at least, is because it gives you a perspective of what it takes to this. This 2016, that kind of finished. I think the city started buying property, dilapidated property in that area, because it was just to clean things up to a large degree, probably 35 years ago.
Yes.
I remember when we bought things as it came available. We would have done more if we had money, but we didn't really have money. But those, and when I say the city, I mean the redevelopment agency, because the city really wouldn't have been able to do that. But that, so there's a project that now is a great commercial center, I think anybody would say. Costco is doing very well. Everybody there is doing well. That gas station has got to be doing well. You can't drive up to a pump. You can drive up to get in the shortest line. But that's a long process.
It is.
I know your personal efforts in putting that property together, since we were committed, even though in those days we still had the right of eminent domain for commercial projects, we were committed we weren't doing eminent domain for at least residential, and we were trying to do everything without it, although we did have the tool that there was some tax advantage of people were able to get. But we owned about a third, I think, of the mm-hmm. property by the time Costco right. came along. You were able to get the rest of it acquired and everything. And now that will be probably for the next 30 or 40 years, certainly next 20 or 25, very likely producing a substantial amount of income for the city to provide services.
You know, it's interesting looking back, it took a while to put it together. As folks look back now, Costco came first. And it was the only development for some time. And then, you know, it was okay for a restaurant to come, a couple of restaurants. And then it kind of stayed there for a bit.
Because there was a pretty good recession.
And then it was a while before the next, and only came available when the market was ready to move. And so then it came in segments, in certain thresholds. And because what was simply opened in 2016, all of those restaurants, really, 2 years ago, it was just beginning to come online with interest and market, and it took about a year to the market to fully mature, but now it's open and operating. And so it hasn't all happened at once, you know, and sometimes folks say, well, can't you just go make it happen? And that's what market forces are, and people willing to make investments. Every property, every business on that site is a private person putting their money to make that business happen. And they've got to be comfortable making that investment.
Probably a substantial part of our increased assessed value is a result of the investments there.
Right. In fact, I'll give you the numbers. Before the project was started, it was basically $6 million value for 22 acres. Now, after it's fully built out, and we don't have the full numbers, we won't till next year, but it's $44 million. So you go from $6 million to $44 million, you know, just with the evaluation of the property, plus, of course, its retail value.
Yeah, pretty phenomenal. There's another thing that I know this is the season for political things, and we have a city council election, but by the way, I was told that there was on and I believe you told me that there was the rumor that somebody, and I have no idea who and whether it has anything to do with any campaign or not, but the rumor about that the reason we did the downtown redevelopment, that we changed everything, the renovation, and removed the wooden sidewalks, was that my wife had broken the heel off her shoe. I told her that. She was a little irate about it because she pointed out she never, ever, had any problem with the wooden sidewalks. She never broke a heel on her shoe. In fact, she hasn't worn high heels for years and years and years. But it's funny how things like that start when the reality is that that was a long, long process, and probably the prime motivator in us making the decision finally that we would have to remove the wooden sidewalks was not because they created a great hazard for anything, although some women did say you could break your heel off your shoe, but the standards for deviations, like thresholds at doors and everything, to qualify for aid to meet the requirements of the Americans with Disabilities Act, just got to be, it was probably impossible to maintain those because you can't have more, it has to be, you can't have any deviation more than half an inch. Legally, you can, you don't have any legal liabilities if you have one up to 3/4 of an inch on a sidewalk, but you don't meet ADA safe paths, clear paths. So ultimately, that's why we did that. But if you, so if you happen to hear that rumor, or if you happen to see my wife and say anything to her about the, that she's the cause of it all being redone, it's not true. The other thing I was thinking about, Blaine, is that there's also people who say, well, why did we raise the fees for business licenses and for services every year that we do with a vote, and we do it by the cost of living, which we are permitted to do without going to a vote of the people. So I was thinking about the sheriff's contract this last year. Sheriff's contract is about a third of our budget.
Yes.
The increase had to be 7 or 8%.
This last year was 4, but it...
But how about the liability trust fund?
Yeah.
Add that to it.
Yes. And so, and it's going to be higher because they put in a labor agreement, a multi-year labor agreement, and we pay basically on the previous year. And so we went up 4% because of a liability trust fund, but it's going to go up even greater because there'll be some compensation issues.
So that, and it, if you, the sheriff's contract is likely, I mean, it meets, it goes up at least as much as the cost of inflation.
Yes.
And sometimes frequently, I mean, it has gone more. And I'm not saying that the deputies, in fact, had not received raises for quite a while. And there was I don't think any of us are complaining about,
right,
about what they're being paid at all. But pretty substantial increase. And depending on whatever the timing is, in this year, because it comes up with pay for the year we're in, it was a 3.5% or 3 or 3.5% on the liability trust fund. Good news, it's only going to be 0.5% next year.
Okay.
We're only going to 10. But still, those costs, so if we don't keep our fees in line, costs are still going up.
Right.
And we will, cities that have gotten behind, they have a very difficult time catching up. They end up going into bankruptcy.
We've got 1 minute over your left shoulder.
Okay, so you've got it.
I think that's a good point, Curt. You know, the city has bills too. Every, and businesses do, families do. We pay utilities, we pay for water, you know, and we want to keep up with those. We consider it a responsibility to provide municipal services. And those costs, we are a consumer. We pay the costs associated with that. And so but our promise is that we'll spend it well and that we won't, it will not be an extreme fee. We have the lowest fees and charges, and so, and we like it that way, but it's important to stay current.
Well, it is indeed. Okay, our time is up. Good night. Thank you for, thanks for the call, Pat. And anybody else would like to call us next time? We will have a guest next time. Thank you.